Programming language conferences are usually self-congratulatory and filled with positivity meant to sell the language to new users. But when the ecosystem matures, you start seeing more realistic presentations dealing with friction points and dark corners. This is one of those talks. NIMS object-oriented programming has surprising behaviors. Stuff like hidden coercion of child types to their parent type triggered by procedure parameters. This combined with a runtime type information implementation that is no longer able to give you the child type after this implicit cast forces you to use generics instead of polymorphism. And generics have their own problems. You might have noticed what looks like some types obtained by ordering two existing types Haskell style. They're called type classes and they're declared in type sections but are not actual types. These are in reality hidden generics. When you use a procedure parameter with a type class, the procedure becomes generic, the parameter is specialized for each of the involved real types, and the type class is erased during compilation. When you import multiple modules from the same directory, you can group them using brackets to save you some typing. The surprise comes when the directory is relative, that is, it starts with one or two dots. The parser will fail, and the workaround is placing double quotes around those dots. Metaprogramming is a very powerful feature that lets you obfuscate code in marvelous ways. For example, you can define a question mark template that hides an early return from the procedure calling it. Your collaborators will just have to learn this Rust-inspired syntax extension and keep an eye out for question marks associated with result types. The real fun starts with write-only macros that make Perl look like literate programming in comparison, the kind where you need to print the resulting AST to get a hint about their inner workings. And macros can be combined with templates for twice the fun. NIMS versatile compiler is quick to build and supports many platforms. The bootstrap process starts with pre-generated C files from an older version of this compiler within NIM. Until recently, building this initial stage was not being done in parallel, even though a suitable makefile was already being generated for it. Furthermore, these C files were fetched from the head of a different Git repository, just like the source for Nimble. So the only way to get reproducible compiler builds was to write your own build script where you could specify target commits. Things have improved in the develop branch. A custom build script is still needed if you want to only build three compiler stages instead of four, but don't try to build just two. The resulting compiler can compile itself again, but may fail in delightful ways on long compiler code because it uses some internal flags from the old bootstrapping compiler. This is where you find out that the compiler is written in an old and well-tested subset of the language. Most new language features are first tested in the wild because core developers will not dogfood them in the compiler itself. Unfortunately, this is common in languages where the main focus is the self-bootstrap compiler. There are efforts underway to automate testing suites of many third-party NIM projects in the compiler CI, but failures there might not hold back a new compiler release. Let's talk about new releases. Minor or even patch number version changes may bring backwards incompatible language changes, or even show-stopping bugs, discouraging regular compiler updates for non-trivial code bases. Anyway, you've built a compiler and now you're using it to compile multiple NIM programs in parallel, using a makefile, while also using link time optimization to squeeze more performance out of your CPU-intensive software. Why is the total number of processes sky-high all of a sudden? Well, the NIM compiler will generate C code in a single process for each program, but then will invoke a number of C compiler instances equal to the number of CPU cores to compile those resulting C files. Each of those instances will also automatically parallelize part of the LTO step, also based on the number of your CPU cores. You want to reduce the total number of processes, and MEC has a way of letting child processes ask for slots before starting. But the NIM compiler doesn't implement that protocol, so it disables its parallelism. GCC does speak that MEC protocol, but only if it can read some environment variables set by MEC. The NIM compiler doesn't pass those on. Furthermore, the NIM compiler keeps running while the C files are compiled, taking up non-trivial amounts of RAM. Most I've seen is 2.1 GB. Fortunately, you can decouple the C generation phase from the C compilation phase. It's done when building the NIM compiler itself, though not exactly advertised for regular users. Instead of staying in RAM while GCC is doing its job, you can have the NIM compiler generate a JSON file containing all the C compilation info, then exit. A new invocation of the NIM compiler, with the right arguments, will read this JSON file and start the C compiler. This new instance is much lighter than the first one, so it solves the maximum RAM usage problem. To also solve the LTO parallelism problem, you need to write a small tool to convert that JSON file into a makefile. Don't expect LTO to work easily on Windows though, because R and runlib names are hard-coded, with no way to override them like you need to do for environments like MinGW. Remember the part where we're building multiple new programs in parallel? At some point, we'll need to build two different programs using the same source file as an entry point. That's when we discover that the internal namecache subdirectory is named after the source file, not the output name. So we write a small wrapper to override the namecache path based on the output name. By now, you might raise your eyebrows at the claim that the namecompiler is the only build tool you'll ever need, but wait, there's more. Some Nim users who don't like the old-fashioned way of dealing with reusable C code by putting it in libraries will just ask the Nim compiler to add individual C files to the compilation whenever the Nim module wrapping them is imported. Those C files will be rebuilt for each different Nim program using the wrapper. Maybe those old-fashioned people were onto something. We all know that Nim code is transformed into C code, but not many realize that C code is not optimal. If you enable the default stack traces, some function calls are inserted to keep track of an internal procedure call stack frame. Unfortunately, this prevents tail call optimization by the C compiler. So we just write a small tool to generate stack traces using only runtime information and debugging info to get rid of that overhead that makes even the Nim compiler disable stack traces for itself by default. Fortunately, we only need to wrap existing libraries like libunwind and libbacktrace and plug the new stack tracing mechanism in the compiler. It's not trivial, but it works. What doesn't work is guessing when a heap object will be copied on a stack due to hidden temporary variables, or figuring out that C strings can't prevent the garbage collection of string objects they point to due to internal memory scanning implementation details. The Nim runtime is not optimal either. The default garbage collector has a rather high memory fragmentation rate and no compaction support. Remember the old BoMGC, a conservative tracing garbage collector where pointers point to the start of allocated memory regions? The default MGC doesn't do that. It's a deferred reference count MGC combined with a marker sweep tracing GC. This tracing part is similar to BoM, but allocated regions start with a metadata header and the return pointer has an offset equal to the length of that header. The associated pointer math can sometimes be optimized by the C compiler, and a garbage collection at the wrong time may not find the pointer it looks for during its stack and register scan. At that point, it mistakenly decides an allocated region should be freed, and this subtly corrupts your memory, only a little, only rarely. The problem has been fixed, but some people still have scars from the debugging session. Fun fact, the mark and sweep phase is disabled inside the Nim compiler for being too slow. The standard library is very useful when it works. A module like Threadpool, very important for using multiple CPU cores, will sometimes deadlock, probably due to its overly complicated elastic worker pool size and features like support for workers launching new workers. The Nim compiler comes bundled with a series of useful tools like the always fashionable language-specific package manager, one that will laugh in your face if you try to set up reproducible builds. NimSuggest is started by default by most IDE plugins to provide smart completion. Most users disable it when they figure out how slow and resource-hungry it is. So why do we put up with all this? Why do we keep building and rebuilding our castles on sand? Maybe we enjoy the struggle. What is life if not a continuous fight against entropy? What is software development if not a long series of problems that need solving? And there are satisfactions to be had in this struggle, because Nim is a genuinely fun, extendable, and hackable. It's the Gen 2 of programming languages, freedom for freedom's sake. Sure, you'll break some stuff while juggling chainsaws, but you'll grow by learning how to fix it. Nim has 1,887 open issues and 227 open pull requests. You can fix bugs, pile up more features, experiment with any programming language concept that tickles your fancy, make friends, make enemies, make a living. I'm Stefan Talpalaru and I struggle with Nim. Join the fight.